In this series of videos, we go deep into the years of private politics between Michael Jackson and Janet Jackson. First, a big thank you to all of you who continue to support this channel by purchasing our new merch, available while stocks last. The link is in the description box below. If you haven't already, check out part one where we delve deeper into Michael and Janet's family dynamics during childhood. Overwhelmed and heartbroken after her failed attempt at marriage, Janet asked to be released from her Fame TV contract and spent several weeks anxiously thinking about her next move. Jackson family ties had irreversibly broken down since her brother's victory tour, when after months of feuding and battles for control, her brother Michael abruptly announced on stage in Los Angeles that the band was breaking up, and this was in fact their last show. Janet described how after Thriller, her and Michael would never experience the same affinity as they had in childhood. Even though they both still lived in the Jackson family home, Michael isolated himself from the rest of the family, choosing to focus on solo projects like recording for his next album or working on his film collaboration with Disney, Captain EO. Wanting to break free from her bubblegum pop star image, Janet decided to make another album, but this time, she wanted a whole new sound that expressed her true feelings. When she expressed this to longtime family friend and A&M executive John McClain, he recommended Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis to help produce the record. Jam and Lewis were both, at that point, best known as prodigies of 1985's hottest music commodity, Prince, as they originally played keyboards and bass in the spin-off band The Time. And after Prince's steep ascent to pop superstardom, they were now at the forefront of Minneapolis's burgeoning music scene. However, Janet's father and manager, Joe Jackson, wasn't convinced. With the Jackson brothers disbanded and after losing all control of Michael's future solo projects, the Jackson patriarch was hesitant about loosening his grip on Janet's fledgling career. Janet's father requested that the album be recorded in Los Angeles, where he could keep an eye on the project as well as his daughter. But Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis refused. The plan was for Janet to record with them in Minneapolis, far from the distractions of Hollywood and the interference of her manager father. Quote, "It was hard for Joe to let go of her. We required that they put her in our hands. We felt it was important to get her out of the protective fairy tale life she had been leading," Lewis said in an interview. Joe Jackson still wasn't thrilled with the arrangement, but agreed to let Janet go under one condition. Quote, "Don't make her sound like Prince." When Janet Jackson arrived in Minneapolis, she expected to get straight to work, laying down some tracks and recording her vocals. But for the first week, Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis decided to take the time to get to know the young Jackson. Having just come out of a personal ordeal and with time to reflect on her marriage, family, and career, Janet was unaware that her new producers were busy taking notes that would later inspire the record's overall direction. Over a period of 7 weeks, Janet recorded and co-produced a batch of semi-autobiographical tracks. Outside of her sheltered family life in the showbiz bubble, Janet felt free to, quote, "write about subjects I thought girls could relate to. To let them know that they weren't alone. People feel that this line of work is so glamorous and there's no heartache and nothing ever happens to you." Musically, Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis used their trademarked jackhammer minimalism, whiplash electronic tempos, and lean synthesizer riffs to give a new edge to Janet's small bird-like voice. Jimmy Jam said, quote, "All we ever try to do is bring out the personality. Janet was a stick of dynamite, and we lit the fuse." In early 1986, Janet Jackson was reintroduced to the music-buying public with videos for What Have You Done For Me Lately and Nasty, in which the teenage singer presented a new streetwise demeanor and cocky attitude that was very much at odds with the Jackson family's picture-perfect public image. In preparation for her musical comeback, Janet put herself on a strict diet and chose to differentiate herself from her brother's rhinestones by adopting a sleek, all-black attire accompanied with accent jewelry, most notably a key she would often wear on a hoop earring, a visual statement not unlike the sparkling glove her brother made iconic. During Michael's extended musical hiatus after the successes of Thriller, Janet thrilled audiences with a much-needed dose of Jackson on radio airwaves and on TV screens. Creating music video magic, Janet was able to, with the help of choreographer Paula Abdul, flaunt her dancing abilities in lavishly choreographed routines not dissimilar to the classic Hollywood musicals her and Michael watched growing up. Named Control, Janet's third album made a bold statement, and the record's biographical premise gave an insight into the personal dynamics behind music's most speculated showbiz family. Janet's latest invention raised the eyebrows of more sedate members of the Jackson clan, including Michael, who were concerned about Janet changing up her good girl image. Believing that, especially as a young black female, Janet's aggressive, no-nonsense persona might turn off male DJs and make her unlikable to mainstream audiences. However, their concerns were unfounded, as Control grew to be a runaway hit, becoming Janet's first number one charting album, with five of its singles peaking within the top five of the Billboard Hot 100 Singles chart, achieving her first number one hit single with When I Think of You. With his dazzling dance moves, Michael was able to amass an immense following of young fans. And now, just a few years later, Janet was able to recruit much of that audience with the same family showmanship but added in her own unique relatability with Tales of Teenage Rebellion. In the days before Michael's Bad album, Janet offered audiences a darker, edgier shade of Jackson. After selling 10 million copies worldwide, Janet Jackson was clearly commercially very successful. But having always dreamt of winning high-profile awards, she was also ecstatic to be nominated for 3 Grammys and 9 American Music Awards, winning 2 for Favorite Soul Single and Female Soul Video. Quote, "I feel really wonderful. I've always wanted to establish my own identity without my family, and I feel so good I've done it." Ironically, to counterpoint Janet's stated position that she has seized control, speculation grew as to who should be taking credit for Janet's new wave of success, her father Joe or her A&M Svengali, John McClane. Joe Jackson said, quote, "People know I'm the backbone of the Jackson family. The problem comes when others try to steal them away. The wheels had already been set in motion for Janet. Anyone who jumps on the bandwagon now will be getting a free ride. If Janet listens to me and works a little harder, she'll be as big as Michael." Others credited Janet's newfound popularity to Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis's Minneapolis sound, or Paula Abdul's talent in choreographing several of the promotional videos for Control, as she soon emerged as a star herself with a string of number one hits. The tempting assumption being that Abdul was the real talent and that Jackson merely benefited in the videos from Abdul's extraordinary dance sense. Confronted with this, Jackson said, quote, "It sounds so selfish to say, but it bothers me that some people think someone gave me an image or told me what songs to sing or what clothes to wear. I'm not a robot. I want people to know that I'm real." However, another rumor that persisted within gossip columns and school playgrounds was that Janet and her brother Michael were in fact the same person. That her moonwalking brother was in fact orchestrating an elaborate publicity stunt, producing music and videos under the disguise of his sister Janet. Just one of a whole host of outlandish stories Janet Jackson was questioned about concerning her brother, as she constantly defended Michael's somewhat bizarre behavior and changing appearances due to plastic surgery. Quote, "You know, so many stars do that, but the press picks on certain people. I think if more people could afford it, they would do it too. I see nothing wrong with it. Aging is a sad thing. I don't see anything wrong with staying young-looking as long as you can," the Control singer said. Although Janet felt like her brother's immense celebrity overshadowed her own successes, later many saw Janet's influence reflected in Michael Jackson's Bad album and music videos, as both records featured stripped-down, robotic funk grooves. Jackson also went streetwise and echoed the gravelly, whisper-to-a-screech voice Janet adopted for Nasty, as well as his own tough cookie attitude, like a belated rebellion against the discipline of a childhood spent on stage. Thanks for watching! Hit subscribe and watch out for part 3, where we chronicle Janet's rise to pop superstardom and how her many professional accomplishments strained relationships with Michael and the rest of the Jackson family. We'll see you next time.